Continuing our countdown to the top teams in college football with the Florida Gators, who come in at number 12 in our preseason rankings. Dan Mullen coming off his first division championship, but Florida lost a lot, especially on the offensive side of the ball. They lost Heisman finalist Kyle Trask. They lost top five pick Kyle Pitts. And even on defense, they lost a top 10 pick in C.J. Henderson at the defensive back position, the cornerback position. Florida picked second in the SEC East behind Georgia. Georgia coming in at number 5 in the CBS Sports preseason 130. A couple of SEC West teams ahead of them as well. At number 7, you have Texas A&M. And number 1, Bama, who the Gators will host in their first SEC game of the season in Week 3. Let's get Barrett Salee in here to break down the Gators. And yes, they are 12th in the nation in our preseason poll. They are a New Year's Six contender. But with all they lost, Barrett, can we really expect Dan Mullen to build off last season?
I think building off of it is a little bit aggressive because they went to the SEC championship game, gave Alabama a pretty good game in Mercedes-Benz Stadium. I think this year, because of the losses, it might be a little bit more difficult for them to compete, especially considering Georgia is revved up, ready to go in that SEC East. Look, I understand Dan Mullen's a quarterback whisperer. Dan Mullen's an offensive genius. But when you lose all the pieces that Florida had, then I think it might be a little bit more difficult to repeat what they had last year.
Well, they have had the succession plan for Kyle Trask in place for quite some time. Emory Jones entering his fourth year with the program. What do you expect from the former four-star who has yet to start a game at the college level?
Well, he's going to run an awful lot. Kyle Trask was a statue back there. You're not going to see that from Emory Jones. You're going to see the more Dak Prescott-style offense that Dan Mullen ran at Mississippi State. That's what he came up knowing. Tim Tebow, another perfect example. Now, is Emory Jones Tim Tebow? No. But you're going to see more of the running game from the quarterback. Look, they've been ranting and raving about Emory Jones' arm this year, not only in fall camp, but also in spring practice. Dan Mullen even told us at SEC Media Days that how strong he is as a passer. We need to see that first. And we need to see it considering they have three new weapons outside at receiver. Their offensive line's just sort of shaky. It's going to be on Emory Jones. There's a lot of pressure on him right now. I think the expectation for the offense is that it'll change. You'll see more zone read action. You'll see more running out of the quarterback spot. But they're still going to have to stretch the field. They're still going to have to find a passing game. And I think that's the biggest challenge facing the Gators in fall camp.
So you're replacing a Heisman finalistic quarterback. You're also replacing your top three pass catchers, including maybe the best tight end to ever come out of college football. How do you replace that kind of talent and production from the likes of like Kyle Pitts, like Kadarius Toney and others?
Yeah, they were all right last year outside, right? And Kyle Pitts, man, you can't replace him. And unless you have some sort of cloning machine in Gainesville, you can't replace him. But I think you can do different things. Obviously, getting a bunch of receivers, a bunch of running backs out of the backfield as receivers. You saw Dan Mullen do that at Mississippi State quite a bit. That'll be part of it. They've got Justin Shorter, a guy transfer for Penn State, who's played quite a bit. Jacob Copeland also is a veteran former starter from last year, stepping into more of a contributor role this year, a starter, a 1A type option this year. So there are some options. Timor Gamble, we saw him when Kyle Pitts went out against Georgia. Pretty good tight end as well. So there are options. And really, when it comes to the passing game, you're not necessarily going to need to see those Kyle Pitts, the Kadarius Toney, different variations downfield. You just need to find one or two options that can make the passing game a threat. If the passing game is just a threat, if you can keep those safeties honest, then I think it's going to help what the offense will become, and that's more of a multidimensional rushing attack.
Yeah, and that's due in large part to the new quarterback, Emory Jones, who can run it a heck of a lot better than Kyle Trask. And they also return a ton of options at the running back position. So how do you see Dan Mullen splitting things up in the backfield?
Well, it's going to be by committee, and it's a pretty darn good committee, too. DeMarcus Bowman's a kid they like a lot. We have Malik Willis back, obviously. He's been around, it seems like, forever. Same with Damian Pierce. All those guys kind of do some different things. So I think because of that, you're going to see Dan Mullen mix and match. You're going to see DeMarcus Bowman maybe a little bit more out of the backfield as a receiver. You're going to see him mix and match in a bunch of different ways. You're not going to see what he did with Dak Prescott, which is have Josh Robinson go out there and run for 1,200, 1,300 yards. They're going to get involved in different ways, and I think because Emory Jones is such a threat outside that you're going to see variation. So I like their running backs. But you have to worry about the offensive line, because the offensive line was just okay last year. I think the expectation is that it's probably going to be the same this year. If they can get above average play along the offensive line, then that running game's in good hands, because there are options everywhere back there.
Start the season against FAU, then they have South Florida. And to really get going, they have their first SEC game of the season, the biggest test of all, Alabama, coming to the Swamp, week three. Right now, the spread is about 2 touchdowns in favor of the Crimson Tide. Can Florida challenge in that game? What kind of a hope do they have to keep it close?
I don't think they have much of a hope. I think when it comes to Florida, look, you're going to have to score about 30 points a game, sort of like last year. I don't buy their defense. I think their defense is a liability. I think their defensive coordinator is a liability. So if that's the case, then you're going to ask Florida to score 30 points on a defense that Alabama is going to boast that is going to be filthy. Veterans all over the place. And I just don't see how Florida's offense will be able to handle that. So I don't think they have much of a chance against Alabama. If this game was played later in the season, okay, maybe, because Florida would have a chance to sort of get its bearings, figure out what it is offensively. But week three, without really much of a test, I have a hard time believing they're going to move the ball up and down the field, score 30, 35 points against that Crimson Tide defense. And against Alabama, even though there's so many different pieces offensively from last season, you're still going to have to score that and get up there in points, because Bill O'Brien, Bryce Young, we know these guys, John Mechie, all really talented players. The athletes are still there. So I don't give them much of a chance against Alabama.
That's on CBS September the 18th. About a month later, Florida is at LSU in a rematch of one of the biggest upsets and one of the more bizarre endings of last season in college football. Florida and LSU fans now know it as the shoe game, when LSU stunned Florida as a 23-point dog, Barrett.
That game was wild, man. In the fog, Marco Wilson throwing the shoe. And I think what people forget about that game is that LSU was down like 20 scholarship players due to a variety of different reasons, and they still got the job done. And I think for Dan Mullen, that's got to be concerning, because your team at that point was still in the national championship hunt in that game. But I'm excited to see this game. I think there's this idea that LSU is just going to be sort of a pushover this year. I think last season, at the end of the season, when they beat Florida, when they beat Ole Miss at the end of the regular season, that gave them some confidence. I really like this LSU team, younger players. It's going to be a challenge. There's no doubt when Florida and LSU square off. I have my doubts that Florida will be able to match LSU score for score. So it'll be fun, though. After what we saw last year in this game, anything's possible. I mean, look at that fog. That game was just absolutely wild.
Yeah, it's a good thing for SkyCam in that matchup. All right, want to get your pick here. The over-under win total for the Gators is at 9. They're 14-1 to win the SEC.
Yeah, not going to pick them to win the SEC. And at 9, I would really like a hook one way or the other. So in reality, I'm not going to take my money, go to a window and bet this game or bet this team. But I've got them with 3 losses right now. I've got them losing to Alabama, got them losing to LSU, and I've got them losing to Georgia. So with that said, do I think they'll lose a toss-up game somewhere along those lines? Yeah, I think they might lose a toss-up game. You cannot count on them being that good consistently to win all those. So I'll take the under, but like I said, right now I've got them at 9-3, so I'd really like a hook one way or the other.
All right, that's Barrett Salee breaking down the Florida Gators, who are 12th in our preseason poll. You can find the whole thing, the CBS Sports preseason 130 on cbssports.com. Tomorrow we get to the number one ranked group of 5 team. That would be the Cincinnati Bearcats coming in at number 11. And then next week, beginning Monday, we are into the top 10 with Notre Dame.
Do you want a sports network that delivers everything that matters about the game? The highlights, the picks, the instant analysis. No yelling, no fake debates, no politics. Hit the subscribe button and never miss a moment.